Throughout our history, Americans have been welcoming home the survivors of war. Now, after a decade of indecisive battle, the war in Vietnam is said to be winding down.
I am a Vietnam veteran, a ex-Marine medic, and an ex-morphine addict. I went on an operation called Operation Allen Brook, and we were sweeping a ville. A Marine that was in my company was with us for about 2 weeks, heard noise behind him, turned around and sprayed the area. He hit 3 women and some children. This is a normal reaction, but when he put the gun up to his shoulder and took individual aim, he was committing murder. That night, when we set up our perimeter, I shot morphine for the first time because of what had happened that day to me. This was the only way that I could rationalize why I was there and what I was doing there.
Experts guess there may be 40,000 or more hardcore drug addicts among our homecoming GIs. They have been trained to kill and come fresh from a place where life and heroin come cheap. Now they face the problem of adjusting to a society in conflict with itself, finding work amidst economic decline. Tonight, Assignment 4 looks at what is being done for the GI junkie. When President Nixon declared a national offensive on the GI drug problem, a major burden fell initially on the Veterans Administration. The VA hospital in Menlo Park is one of 32 drug treatment centers set up thus far throughout the nation. Primarily a mental hospital and nursing home, the Menlo Park division is slowly attracting young GIs with drug problems. They come initially to the detoxification unit, opened in August 1971, where they are gradually withdrawn from their physical dependency on drugs.
We are detoxing GI drug addicts with the use of methadone, actually depending on what type of habit they have. We have a ward capacity for 30, but only 15 of the beds are operating right now. Up to this point, we haven't had a full capacity of 15 yet. When you're ignorant of something, you are afraid. And this is the main reason that they don't come. Usually a guy is sick when he gets here. So we try to cut admission down to approximately 10 minutes. And he is brought directly to the ward. He's given his initial dose of methadone, then we search their clothing. They stay in hospital clothing because the detox is very short. It's about 3 to 5 days. The next day, there is a screening that is done with the staff. And by the staff, I mean the nurses and the drug counselors, who are all ex-junkies. We sort of find out where he's at, what type of habit he's had, what he plans to do, and what does he expect from us. And we also tell him what we expect from him, because there are certain rules and regulations. They will not involve themselves in any type of violence. They are allowed one phone call during their stay here, and there are no visits. And this is done mainly to keep contraband from coming into the ward. I would say about 75% of them go on methadone maintenance.
About 50 ex-GI addicts are now on outpatient status. They must return daily either to Menlo Park or a newly opened satellite clinic in San Francisco for their dose of methadone. A synthetic narcotic, methadone is itself addicting, but it blocks the effect of heroin while satisfying the addict's drug hunger, permitting him to function normally. Those on methadone are mostly older, so-called hardcore addicts, but a few are young Vietnam veterans who became heavily addicted to the 95% pure heroin available in Vietnam.
We have here a comprehensive drug abuse unit, which I think we're extremely fortunate in having. It's very rare in this day and time. We have essentially 3 treatment programs aside from our detox unit. which are long-term programs that attempt to help the man change his lifestyle, to get out of the lifestyle of addiction and to clean up over a period of from 3 to 6 months. And most of our referrals go into one of the drug programs, one of the long-term live-in drug programs.
One such program calls itself The Family. It serves a mixed group of mostly older men afflicted with what psychiatrists call character disorders, sex offenders, criminals, and alcoholics, as well as drug abusers. 8 miles away at the VA's new hospital in Palo Alto, there is a specialized treatment program aimed specifically at the young GI.
Half of the people in my unit never even got loaded before they went to Vietnam.
Ward 4B2 is described as a therapeutic community. About 20 ex-GIs live here and undergo a highly structured regime of individual and group psychotherapy. A third to a half of them are and probably will remain on methadone. To be admitted, one must convince a screening committee that he is sincere in wanting to quit the drug culture. Of 100 who've been accepted thus far, 60 have completed the 3 to 6 month program and are reported to be living stable, productive, and drug-free lives. The VA's third and most experimental rehabilitation effort is housed in Ward 105B2 at Menlo Park. About 25 ex-GIs live in this ward, and they follow a strict, self-imposed daily routine that begins at 6:30 a.m. Unlike the VA's other treatment programs, this one is entirely patient-run and does not accept men on methadone. Those who make it do not consider themselves patients or inmates. They are voluntary members of a self-help program modeled after Synanon. They are here because they are willing to face their drug problem and able to convince a screening committee that their motivation is strong enough to survive the 5 stages of the program. But a third of those who apply are turned down, and another third do not finish. Those who remain subject themselves to months of rigorous self-analysis through daily rounds of attack therapy. The program members would not allow us to film an attack therapy session, but program director Steve Petty, a psychiatric social worker, explains its purpose.
What we do is we watch people for self-destructive behavior, and we tell them about it. We reflect it back to them. We make them sort of stop and take a look at the kinds of things they're involved in. We don't attack people. We only attack self-destructive behavior. I could almost give you a money-back guarantee that this program is free from illegal drugs, because we avoid the cops and robbers game of us and them. In essence, there really is no staff in this program, only program members. We don't preach total abstinence. Our philosophy is that drugs are really not a problem. They're symptomatic of lifestyle problems. A person is hurting in some way and takes drugs for a specific reason. Once those problems, those causing problems, have been taken care of, then chemical use becomes incidental. I think we've dealt with between 150 and 200 people in the year and a half, well, nearly 2 years that we've been in existence. And the people who move through the various phases of the program, complete the program, and graduate, generally seem to be very successful. Like, when I came into this program, I don't know whether I really had a sincere desire to get myself together. After a few weeks, I started getting one.
Oh, it's been beautiful, you know, like, I really didn't think it could be this good.
Got my confidence back, and I think that's what I needed most.
You know, like when I came here, I was still a lying con. You know, I lied a lot. The games here, the therapy group's about the only thing that keeps me together.
I don't need no pills no more or a needle in my arm. I mean, like, I'm there. I know what I want. I'm going to go get it. Just a matter of time.
Probably the single biggest problem that we've yet to find some answers to is reemployment. When a person's ready to leave this program.
But the VA's rehabilitation program is not without its critics. One such is Dr. Carl Evans, Assistant Chief of Staff of the San Francisco Veterans Administration Hospital.
The VA is reaching a few GIs. The great majority of the young veteran coming back, however, are not willing to make the commitments for long-term therapy and for identification that entry into such a program demands. Many, if not most, of the people who enter those programs are already having trouble with the law, are having serious personal problems in terms of keeping up with their habit, so that the discomfort of their habit is very, very high. And this, for the most part, represents late-stage addiction rather than the early thing that we might be treating. I think we ought to take the facilities of the VA out into the community. I think we ought to be participating with the community programs that are going now. I think in areas where there are not effective community programs going, the VA should be the catalyst for bringing these programs into existence.
Dr. Evans proposed a formal relationship be established with the Haight-Ashbury Free Medical Clinic as a way of reaching veterans with drug problems. But the VA in Washington refused to act on his request. The Haight-Ashbury Free Medical Clinic has been dealing with drug problems since it came into being during the 1967 Summer of Love. Thousands of young people flocked to San Francisco that summer to join the latest mass media sensation, the hippie movement. These were the so-called flower children, restless fugitives from middle America, come here to smoke dope, dance in the streets, and in some marvelous but undefined way, change the world. Not everybody who came to the Haight-Ashbury was looking for love. Hoods and bikers came to prey on the young innocents, and so-called respectable people came to gawk and criticize.
We refer to this portion of the Gray Line in the city. It's the first and only foreign tour within the continental limits of the United States. We're now entering what is known as the largest hippie colony in the world. The favorite pastimes of the hippies, besides taking drugs, are demonstrations and partying.
Then came the fall and the police sweeps along Haight Street. The psychedelic experience had become a bummer.
I think in large part that what happened this afternoon was created by the media. I think it was unnecessary. It would be possible to groove if the media would take it on themselves to be responsible in the same way that they take it on themselves to be sensational. It never would have happened.
Most of the young people drifted away. Those remaining symbolically buried the hippie myth that had attracted so much public animosity.
Well, how does it feel to have the hippie dead? It feels very groovy, man. No, we don't have any labels. You have to. Now when the American public... When the American public has to look at it, they'll have to say we're free men instead of any other name. We killed hippies, we killed freebies, we killed everything, man.
The population and the mood of the Haight-Ashbury changed, and so did the pattern of drug abuse. Psychedelics, like marijuana and LSD, gave way to a deadly combination of amphetamines and barbiturates. It took 2 years for the speed barb cycle to run its deadly course. Countless desperate speed freaks now sought a way down off amphetamines. Many found the answer in yet another drug, heroin. By 1969, the Haight-Ashbury Free Medical Clinic had set up its own heroin detoxification center. A year later, it was treating 60 new junkies a day. The Haight-Ashbury was and still is in the throes of a heroin epidemic. Dr. George Gay, at the time a volunteer physician at the Haight Free Clinic, found himself the resident expert on heroin detoxification. Now he is the full-time director of the clinic's heroin treatment program, which is funded with a $366,000 grant from the federal government.
What we have found has been an inflexible structure in the VA hospital, especially at the national level, whereas they are not willing to accept us in our own as we exist. And of course, as we exist, on the streets is the very basis for acceptability to many of these young people who find the structured government institution unacceptable to them. We try to impress on everybody who walks in the door that confidentiality is absolute, that what we are offering is a non-punitive, non-judgmental attempt to help him with his particular problem. And we try to deal with each problem individually. Detoxification of the patient is a very simple procedure. We don't use cold turkey. We attempt to alleviate symptoms with a few mild, non-narcotic, non-barbiturate preparations, such as tranquilizers. And it usually will work through the withdrawal period, which lasts about 3 or 4 days.
And how many times have you been in a heroin treatment program before?
No.
No, no? Okay. How many times have you kicked on your own?
Several.
How many exactly, you know?
Well, every junkie you go through a process of constantly swearing off. You know, Joe Junkie swears off again. Tomorrow, always tomorrow. Sometimes I'll go 3 or 4 days.
Anybody can kick, but it's staying clean. It needs real, prolonged, professional care. First of all, we have to overcome the old adage of once an addict, always an addict. If I believed that, I wouldn't be in the business. I don't think any of us would. Street people are the people who we're dealing with. And so we use them to help us communicate with their subculture, which is now our subculture. Generally, on paper, we call them outreach workers or street workers. And this indeed is the work that they do. Also, they serve as counselors many times as effectively or more effectively than a trained psychologist.
When you come down, you're very hypertensive and hyperactive.
I don't have your file here. How long have you been clean now?
About righteously clean for about a week and a half. You know.
Well, you're feeling good then, huh?
Yeah, sure.
Sure, man.
Sure. You know, just trying to get it.
This is where we come to be re-energized, to get strength, to cope.
Heroin is not the disease, it's a symptom of the disease. So what we do is we try to offer them counseling on an individual or on a group basis. We offer psychodrama, which helps some people act out their particular problems and perhaps understand them a little bit better. I think you scared the out of me.
Do you want me or do you want some kind of victory ale for me?
A lot of people seem to have women who take care of them and love them. And I've always wanted and I've always had an ego victory over you and your kind. Yeah, but I don't want that anymore.
It's obvious that you don't love me. You're not giving.
You arrive at a point in the ex-heroin user when the very thought of heroin is so repellent to him that he makes a face almost involuntarily. At that point, I'd say this guy is very unlikely ever to go back to drugs. Along the path that we go to get there, there may be a lot of falling down. What you have to do is expect this fella to backslide a little bit and then try and help him during these periods when he is backsliding and try and get him reoriented to a life that is acceptable both to himself and to society.
The kids will tell you that heroin is a death trip. They know it. They embrace it. I don't understand it. I don't think any doctor ever has understood suicide in any of his patients.
Dr. Irving Klumpas, a retired physician and AMA official, is the Hate Free Clinic's medical consultant. He does not pretend to understand the drug culture, yet believes in the clinic's approach to the heroin problem.
First of all, you can't treat junkies unless they come in. And the wide open, unstructured attitude of the medical people and the psychologists who run this clinic, I think, account for the success of this program. About one third will come in, take a look, and decide they're not ready for our program. So these people perhaps are our failures. But two-thirds of the patients stay with us for various periods of time. I've been here long enough to have seen dozens and dozens of cleaned-up junkies without the support of methadone and with very, very few other medicines to combat some of the problems. People have responded to our brand of medicine. And the most important thing is that they come in.
There are GIs showing up here, but at this point, not in significant numbers. I think if we would review the last 100 patients that have come in to see us, perhaps 5 or 6 would be recently discharged GIs. The point that I would like to make is that there are GIs who are out on the street who don't come in to see us, because the physical and psychological pain is not built up to the point where it will overcome the pleasure of shooting dope. We will see them in a period of, 1 year to 3 years. This is the lag phase that we can predict. And we know they're there. It's like knowing that there are fish out there when they're going to bite, but you don't know when.
They wiped my platoon out, you know, and like my, I lost half my intestines and my, almost lost my arm.
And you're seeing your friends getting blown away and stuff for no reason, for a stupid reason, a stupid cause, you know.
And when you're behaving in a way that's very important, like in life or death, you're under a lot of tension. And one way to relieve the tension is to take drugs.
It just seemed like life was nothing. Life meant nothing to me. I just, you know, just, all I thought about was heroin.
Forgive those who trespass against us. But lead us not into temptation.
The first event that blew my mind was getting off the plane in San Francisco and a girl coming up to me and saying, "You are a killer."
Fire! Aim! Fire! Aim! Fire!
The youngsters feel threatened by the VA hospital. It's an extension of the military, and after all, the military is the basis of a lot of their problems.
Many of the young people who are now on drugs represent political attitudes which are not attractive to the establishment.
I think we tolerate a lot of subculture, what people come to call counterculture elements. Our goal is to help people learn how to survive in the real world out there.
I don't think we can talk about the American GI in Vietnam as being someone separate from American society at large. And I think we focus rather strongly on this one problem and the one area of the problem of addiction. And we perhaps missed a good deal of what's going on at home. Addiction is on the upsurge now in the high school population.
Reset! Heart!